Perhaps you've heard people called a lightning rod. Well, when we speak of someone, he's a real lightning rod. It means he's kind of lit up, the center of attention, the one attracting a lot of controversy, seemingly in the middle of it all. Well, Jesus Christ was Mr. Lightning Rod. And this record in Luke 4 is amazing. Verse 14, he had been tempted in the wilderness and overcome the enemy out there. So he comes back to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. Hey, you could live with his power, and I don't know about the whole countryside, but people be talking about you. Sure. Would they be saying only good things? No. Watch. He taught in their synagogues and everyone praised him. Well, good. So far, so good. He went to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue as was his custom, and he stood up to read. That was the custom, to stand up to read the word, the scroll. It says the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written. And you can, if you go to Isaiah 61, verse 1, you'll find that this is exactly where Jesus was reading. But in the day that Jesus was handed the scroll and unrolled it, it didn't have any numbers on it, like 61, chapter 61, verse 1. Those were not added till 1200 A.D., something like that, 12 to 1400 chapters and verses and paragraph markings and all that. So think about it. Not only were there no numbers, but all of the letters ran together with no spaces or paragraphs. That's how it went in Hebrew. And so the scroll of Isaiah, was it 1 foot long? He unrolled the little scroll. Oh, I see it. Uh-uh. It was about 60 feet long, maybe 2-3 feet high. 60 feet! No numbers, no markings. How did he find? It doesn't say he took all day. It doesn't say he said, just come back next Sabbath and I will have found it by then. Hold on, I know it's in here. No, 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 no. He found it immediately and he read, the Spirit, should be small s, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, he was reading, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Sounds awesome. And Jesus stopped on a dime. He actually stopped on a comma. If you look at Isaiah 61, he does not read, and the day of vengeance of our God, because he knew that the day of vengeance of God was at his second coming to the earth to Israel. First coming was the suffering, they killed him. Second coming will be the glory. He will save Israel and set up his earthly kingdom out of Jerusalem, where they are the centerpiece of the earth. And so he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. What's he saying? Hello, I am the man of whom Isaiah is speaking. Verse 22. All, this is unbelievable what we're going to read here. Talk about changing your mind. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. Isn't this Joseph's son? They asked. Jesus said to them, like, wow, we know this guy. He was the carpenter kid. Remember in that time they started their earthly ministry. They began their employment for him, his earthly ministry, at 30 years old, when they had some age under their belt, so to speak. Jesus said to them, surely you will quote this proverb to me, physician, heal yourself. do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum. I tell you the truth, he continued. No prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you. Now listen. Excuse me. Remember what we just read. All spoke well of him. So he goes on. Jesus cuts to the chase. Jesus separates the wheat from the chaff, the sheep from the goats. Because it's the only way to help people. He didn't just pussyfoot around everything. He said, I tell you the truth, no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years, meaning there was no rain, if you read the record. And there was a severe famine throughout the land, yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian. The widow was a Gentile. Naaman was a Gentile. Jesus is saying to them, God couldn't find any believers in Israel. And look at their response. It's not that long a teaching. They weren't mad because he kept them there for hours, apparently. All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. Wait a minute. It's only verse 22. It's about 2 inches in my Bible apart. All spoke well of him, 22, 28. All the people in the synagogue were furious. You know what furious means? It doesn't mean like, hey, I'm offended. No, it means, argh. Excuse me, is this a gamut of emotion here? What is going on? Oh my gosh. They got up, 29, never do this to a teacher, drove him out of town. I could just picture them pushing his head down into the car, you know. They didn't drive him in a vehicle. They drove him out of town and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to let him see the view. No, in order to throw him off the cliff. Wait a minute. He just gave a teaching in the synagogue. At first, they thought it was really good. Sure, as long as it was what they wanted to hear. But when it pricked their hearts, and they had a choice of saying, oh my gosh, you're right. We will repent. We will turn around. We will change. We will believe. No, they went the opposite way. They tried to silence the messenger. They tried to kill him. They took him to the brow of the hill in order to throw him off the cliff. Now, I don't know why Jesus went along with it up until that point. Maybe he was going to make a point. But it says, but, another one of those great buts. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. He walked right through the crowd and he went on his way. I don't know how he did it. He turned and the power of God sliced through that group like a hot knife through soft butter. Then he went down to Capernaum, a town in Galilee, and on the Sabbath began to teach. They were amazed at his teaching because his message had authority. Look at the contrast. In the synagogue, there was a man who was demonized. It had an evil spirit. He cried at the top of his voice, ha, what do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of Israel. Be quiet, Jesus said sternly. Come out of him. Then the demon threw the man down before them all and came out without injuring him. Watch the response here. All the people were amazed and said to each other, what is this teaching? With authority and power, he gives orders to evil spirits, and they come out, and the news about him spread throughout the surrounding area. Mr. Lightning Rod, you can walk with the same kind of power and authority and love and truth, and you can be young Mr. Lightning Rod.